As you all know, pathology is a very colorful staircase to high quality medicine. See, remember there is one Tamil saying, tell me your friend, I will nanban yaar endru sol nee yaar endru solgiren. Tell me your friend, I will tell about you. And we have to apply that to pathology. Tell me your pathology, I will tell about your patient care. That's what we have to tell our clinicians. Can you believe it? 70% of the medical decisions are based on pathological findings. Okay, so we play a very, very vital role in giving a good health care. And the Royal College of Pathologists, UK, they decided to highlight the things, and they have created this handle, I Love Pathology. Okay, and then they, in the year 2014, they thought one of the days in November, we should celebrate it as an International Pathology Day. So I have listed here the years and the days in which we had the International Pathology Day. And luckily, we are all able to meet today, November 11th. An International Pathology Day, even though it is started by UK Royal College of Pathologists, it is sponsored by all the major pathology group. And I think our IAPM also should join. I don't see that name, but we also should join in the celebration of International Pathology Day. And it is celebrated worldwide now. So once again, happy International Pathology Day to all of you. So on this day of 11th November, on the occasion of the International Pathology Day, I thought of telling you all about the art of using artificial intelligence. So the objectives will be, what is AI, why to use it, how to use it, and then we will conclude it with some references. See, this is a beautiful picture. The problem now, many jokes previously we read in various books and we share, so people may not be knowing. But now all the jokes are coming in WhatsApp, Facebook, Twitter. And probably you might have seen this Facebook. This is a picture done 200 years before. And see the typical expression of the examiner and the student looking at the specimen. It has not changed a lot. Like that, the pathology also, there is no much change. The slides are the same, slide holder is the same, microscope is the same. But in our long journey, we had three revolutions in our lifetime. Number one happened at the year of 1980, number two at 2010, and number three at 2018. It is at the peak in 2018. In 1980, the IHC became very, very essential. Up to that time, we have HNE and the histochemistry, but the use of immunohistochemistry had made a lot of changes in the HNE diagnosis, but still HNE is the, they used to say king, I used to say queen, but because even in chess, king is allowed to move in only one square, whereas queen can go anywhere. So HNE is the queen. IHC is ancillary, but it changed, brought a lot of changes from 1980s. In 2010, the magic word, next generation sequencing, has come. And it has made a lot of noise by giving a correct diagnosis. And not only correct diagnosis, it helps us in the precision medicine where we can target each patient, each cancer. So tailored treatment is possible because of NGS. And the third one is the one which we are going to talk now, artificial intelligence, which is the peak in this year. Why artificial intelligence? As a human beings, we are working like machines. We have less time to enjoy, to relax, to learn, to improve, and to innovate. How the ancient Indian people, we should be very proud of our Indian origin, because whatever you go to any place, the things like temples, churches, and mosques, they are all our cultural landmarks. And imagine how much time and money people should have had at that time to build those things. So we should have a very good time to improve and innovate things. But we are like machines. So what you have to do to change it? We have to make the machines work like humans. And that's what we are doing in artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence, by definition, it's a digital computer or computer controlled robot that performs tasks commonly associated with intelligent beings. In artificial intelligence, a lot of jargons are used. I will try to avoid as much as possible. I will try to make it as simple as possible so that everybody can understand. Humans created artificial intelligence, you all should remember. And we created to help us and not to replace us. This is very, very essential thing. You have to keep it in mind. Artificial intelligence cannot replace human beings. And you might have seen in Endran 1, Rajinikanth will be dismantling the robot. Okay. So because they cannot replace the human beings. You have to. What is the difference and similarities between human and artificial intelligence? We speak to each other, we communicate to each other, and artificial intelligence also can do it by speech recognition. We read and write, that can be done by natural language processing, which we will be seeing and further down the slides, that artificial intelligence can do. We can see things. And then artificial intelligence can also see it, but we call it computer vision. We recognize and analyze whatever we see, whatever we hear, whatever we feel. And in the artificial intelligence, it is known as data processing. We see patterns that can be done in AI by pattern analysis. And we have brain to do all these things. And what the thing that artificial intelligence is having, we call it neural network. So these are all the similarities. And what is the main difference? Feelings, bias, inherent human errors, and fatigue. These are all the main drawbacks of human beings. Okay, if you are close to one person, whatever he does, you accept it. If you are working for more than 10 hours, you get the fatigue. Whereas these three things may not be there in AI. That's the major advantage of artificial intelligence. And we learn and remember things, and artificial intelligence in the recent years also learn and they remember things, whatever they learned. Even though we are talking artificial intelligence, I don't know how many of you know that we are using it a lot at present, and I will show you the examples. Phone with Face ID. And I pity the people who spend a lot of money in that, because with the mask, no Face ID can work. Millions and billions of dollars are wasted. But I heard people are working on identifying the face with the mask, and I'm not sure that it will work. Emails. You have different emails. Some of them go into spam, some of them go into business, some of them go into family, because they use filters, and that is also artificial intelligence. I don't know how many of you use smart devices, Alexa, Siri, and all, and they are all artificial intelligence. Google search. Very difficult to be alive now without Google, because everything, for anything and everything, we do the Google search. And that is also a part of artificial intelligence. And the most amazing thing, when you see a movie, for example, I saw Mukuthi Amman in one of the websites. From then on, it is recommending me Nayanthara speak movies. Okay, so that's also artificial intelligence, because it knows Aisa Nayanthara in Mukuthi Amman, and so it is pushing all her movies. Same with Amazon. If you buy one thing, it will give you recommendations. How do they know about us? Because that is of artificial intelligence. So these are all the things which we are using without our knowledge. But what will be happening in future? Enhanced homes, autonomous transport. You all should be hearing about driverless cars. Healthcare, especially in this COVID scenario, they are working on virtual nursing assistants, where robots can behave like assistants which will take care of people without getting the infection. The fourth is virtual reality, and fifth is enjoyable education. The virtual reality gives a enjoyable education, and you all should be having a lot of experience with the webinars. They're all nicest way of educating ourselves and keeping ourselves more knowledgeable. Let us see a small picture of a smart house. This runs for more than 20 minutes, but I edited here and there to make it like 1.5 minutes. But you see here, everything is done automatically, starting from opening of the garage door. And I love that part of dad's office computer getting on by 8 o'clock, because dad will be there. The curtains have been pulled up in the windows. In the evening, the sprinklers, when they are playing, is not functioning. But once they played and then went off, it measured the humidity and the water level on the earth, and then it started functioning. And this is beautiful thing. I think we should be getting all of this in 5 years' time. Okay, time is flying very fast, and we are technically more advanced position now. In 5 years' time, we all of us should be in smart homes. There is no hanging on the lock whether you are locked or not. Just close the door, it will be automatically locked. Get into the car, it will tell you where to go, how to go to the place where you want to go. So everything will be very smart, and this is what happening in the smart homes. Coming to pathology, let us start the history, what we are exposed to development of artificial intelligence. The word artificial intelligence was coined by John McCarthy in 1956. In 1960, the word machine learning has been brought into use. I will tell you what is machine learning. 65, computerized image analysis has come. 86, deep learning has come. 88, convolutional neural network. We will be talking, touching on these things during our discussion. And in 1990, whole slide scanner. The initial whole slide scanner has come in 90s. In 2013, photoacoustic microscope has come. In 2016, there is a microscope called the MUSE, M-U-S-E. I request all the people who are attending the webinar to Google MUSE and see it, because each one of that I can talk about 1 hour. That MUSE will be very, very interesting thing. Please check it on the Google and see what it is. It is one of the innovations that may replace the glass slides. In 2017, Philips received approval for digital pathology whole slide scanner called as IntelliSight. In 2018, FDA gave permission for devices to use artificial intelligence. For example, they got diabetic retinopathy diagnosed by mobile phones. In 2019, the company Leica, with their machine called Aperio, has the permission from FDI to use for whole slide scanning. In 2020, there's another machine called Sectra that got the permission from FDI. This is the timeline of artificial intelligence. I'm just highlighting the areas where the whole slide scanning has become very, very important, because the whole artificial intelligence revolves around whole slide scanner. So a new girl is in the town, and see how the old girl has been ignored. But never ever ignore the old technology. That's the point I want to tell you. Appreciate the new one, but never ignore the cold one, because still light microscopy, immunohistochemistry more important than artificial intelligence. So let us see what's happening in a hospital. Patient with a complaint comes. Since it's I'm going to deal with a surgical pathology, I put a surgeon as a doctor. He did a surgery for the patient. Specimen had come to the pathology department. We did the accession, crossing, processing, and staining. Once the slides are ready, we did the whole slide imaging. And then that whole slide image was given to the pathologist for review. Straightforward cases, final diagnosis is done immediately. In difficult cases, IHCs have been requested. Automated IHC scoring system is used by artificial intelligence to interpret the immunohistochemistry. If molecular testings are requested, again, artificial intelligence help in interpreting the molecular testing. All the additional informations are put together. They all integrated by artificial intelligence, and then final diagnosis was made. Once the final diagnosis was made after integration of all information, it is released into lab information system, hospital information system, otherwise known as HIS, and to the web. And the SMS alert has been sent to the surgeon and also to the patient that the results of their specimen is ready. So this is how our whole day's process is helped by artificial intelligence, starting from the whole slide image, interpreting the IHC, telling us what molecular testing to do and how to interpret, and then coupling all the scores as additional information, integration into information into one final diagnosis, and then released to the web and alerts sent to surgeons and patients. So these are all the help of artificial intelligence. So as you know, there are three phases in pathology. So it's a pre-analytical, and this phase is analytical, and this is post-analytical. And artificial intelligence is very useful in all the three phases of pathology. So let us see three specific things in artificial intelligence. They are nothing but digital image analysis, next generation sequencing, and natural language processing. What is digital image analysis? Whole slide imaging. For example, the glass slides are given to the machines, and the machines read them, scan them, and keep them ready to be displayed into the computer. So it is whole slide imaging. And from these images, data are analyzed and algorithm has been formed. So let us start the data analysis. Algorithms can be derived from the data either by the human or by the computers. When the computers are used for algorithm development for data analysis, they are known as machine learning. Okay. So when human beings are used to write the program to interpret the data, then it is known as classic computing. If machines are used, it is known as machine learning. In machine learning, there are three things you have to remember. One is learning, second one is validation, and third one is testing. Let us see what by one by one. What do you mean by learning? It's a set of known cases is given to you. For example, imagine a mentor, your mentor is teaching the carcinomas, sarcomas, melanomas, a set of known cases. And he tells you what are all the criteria for diagnosis so you can learn. This is what done. Instead of you, it is the computer. All the cases with the criteria are given to the computer, and we have been feeding the computer how to diagnose with this data. So that is known as learning. What is validation? A set of unknown cases. They are again given to you for diagnosis, either carcinoma, sarcoma, or melanoma. Here you means computer, okay? The computer diagnosed carcinoma, sarcoma, and melanoma from set of unknown cases after going through the learning. And then what is the final things? Testing, another set of unknown cases. They are again given for diagnosis, carcinoma, sarcoma, and melanoma, and the outcome is measured in testing. See, validation and testing is more or less the same. But validation is done before a computer is ready for data analysis, so that we can fine tune if there is any mistake in the diagnosis. Whereas testing, it is final product have been put into use and then tested whether it can do a correct diagnosis. For simple examples, learning is like reading for a semester, 6 months. Validation is like having a model exam to know what we have learned. If you are not learning completely, if you are not done very well in the model exam, you have to go back and read again. And then testing is like final exam, where you have to be qualified after clearing the exam. So the machine learning, there are again three types: supervised, semi-supervised, and unsupervised. What do you mean by semi-supervised? Labeled data. Remember, I told you known cases. So these are all known cases given for training to a computer. And from that computer, we made a model. And to that model, we are given the test data for validation and testing. And we measured the output, whether they have been diagnosed correctly. Okay, here, since the machine has learned very well from the known cases, the results are very good. So this is supervised, where known cases are done. Semi-supervised, you can guess it. Both known and unknown cases, labeled and unlabeled data are given to your model. And that model, has after learning, it becomes a predictive model. And that takes the data from the labeled and unlabeled. From the learning done from the labeled data, it correctly classifies the unlabeled data. So the output is not very good as the labeled or supervised, because here we have some semi-supervised method where some unlabeled data is also present. The last one is unsupervised, where all the data have been unlabeled or all the cases are without diagnosis given to a model, and they requested to do a clustering or anomaly detection or dimensionality reduction. These are all the terminologies, but they are nothing but see the uniformity of all the cases. Are they all made up of epithelial cells? Are they all made up of spindle cells? Are they all made up of round blue cells? And then divide them into clusters. For example, the output may be all epithelial cells, all sarcomatous cells or spindle cells, all small blue cells. So here it is unsupervised. So the machine learning is supervised, semi-supervised, and unsupervised. Hope I'm not confusing you all. This basic knowledge is very important for interpretation. You don't have to know every bit of it. Digital image analysis, after this learning, how it is done? It is done mainly by two analogies: features engineering based or deep learning based. What is features engineering based? This is a case of CSOX. This is an image, whole slide image of the machine. And that computer causes segmentation. It differentiates. See, in H&E, we have a blue color and a pink color. Okay. It separates, it segments blue color and pink color differently in stages. Okay. This B and C are the segmentation. After separating it, here you can see nice complete segmentation where you see only the nucleus, and the data from the nucleus can be extracted. Okay. By doing segmentation feature extraction, they can classify the diseases. For example, if it is carcinoma in situ, the nuclei should be more, cytoplasm should be less. So the ratio of the nucleus, extracted nuclear material should be more. And depending upon that, it gets the output. So this is future engineering based digital image analysis. The other one is deep learning based digital image. Literally, it goes deep layer by layer. For example, here there is an image. I know it's not in complete focus. But this image is processed in successive layers. This is one layer, V1, V2 is another layer, V3 is another layer. All the data is analyzed in three layers, and all the layers that are connected are put together, and they have come up with the output. Let us see. For example, V1 is a difference in contrast. V2 may be difference in depth of field. V3 may be color, spatial frequency, and orientation differences. When you combine all these three factors and when you connect the layers, we get a better understanding. But to analyze this, we need a more sophisticated machinery, and that is called as convolutional neural network. Okay, this is more or less equal to our brain, where it collects all information and then put them together with the similarities and then analyze it and then give us the answer. So since this is doing as much as work like our brain, it is known as convolutional neural network, and the machine is known as deep convolutional neural networks. And this is the one that gives high level of performance. So what is the use of digital image analysis in pathology? Practically, it helps in the diagnosis, it helps in the prognosis, and it helps in the theranosis. This is the new terminology where we tell the clinicians what medicine to give for the patient. And lastly, but leastly, it helps in teaching and assessment. In the diagnosis, it does a pattern analysis and then gives a definitive diagnosis or differential diagnosis. And machine itself will tell you what are the further investigations requested. Either it can be immunohistochemistry or it can be molecular in the diagnostic workup. In the prognosis, it can give tumor burden. Imagine, for us, when we do a quantification by our eyeball, it is known as semi-quantification. We cannot differentiate 40% from 41% or 39%. We can differentiate 0 to 40, 40 to 80 without any problem. But when it comes to a very minute details, for example, in neuroendocrine tumors, the mitotic count is 2 to 19 and more than 19. More than 19, the treatment is different. How confident you are to count the mitosis to differentiate 18 and 20? Very difficult, okay? Whereas the machines can do it better. Extent of invasion, tumor grading, measurement of karyotype index, tumor infiltrating lymphocytes, tumor budding. These are all the things that determines the prognosis in the new era. That's why artificial intelligence is very helpful in giving all these prognosis, including micrometastasis in lymph node. How it uses in theranosis? It predicts the response to treatment. For example, you all know osteosarcoma, we have to all embed or the full face of the tumor and assess the degree of necrosis due to treatment. And that can be done in a better way by artificial intelligence. And more importantly, all the images that are scanned as a whole slide image can be stored. Digital slide storage, and the complicated word is digital slide repository. Okay, so I don't want to be a Shashi Tharoor. So let me put it very simple as a digital slide storage. And all the digital slides stored can be used for teaching as well as assessment. We are very proud to say that at Ramachandra, we have the slide scanner. And in this era of COVID, where the slides are very less, we are using this digital slide storage for our postgraduate teaching. So that's all about digital image sequencing. Now we are going to talk about next generation sequencing, or NGS. This is named next generation like 15 years back. We should not be calling it as next generation. And the new terminology proposed is massive parallel sequencing. That's what happening in real life in that machine. Okay, all our DNAs, all our genes are sequenced parallelly in a massive number. So massive parallel sequencing, MPS, should be the preferred name for NGS. And it has a lot of usage. It identifies structural variants in the chromosomes, copy number variants, single nucleotide variants, metamutational data, somatic and germline changes, clonality, chimerism. You name it, you get it in massive parallel sequencing. And the beauty is, in one run, you can get all these things. It is not like do one run, see for this, then in the second run, do for this. In one run, you can get all. And for all of us, this is the future. And there is a nice 2-hour lecture by Dr. Jason Rosenbaum in CAP Virtual Lecture Series. Okay, just type CAP Virtual Lecture Series in Google and go for Next Generation Sequencing by Jason Rosenbaum. He had nicely described the stages. As I told you, NGS is now known as MPS, Massive Parallel Sequencing. There are steps: pre-analytical extraction, library of preparation, sequencing, interpretation, and bioinformatics. Where artificial intelligence comes? Artificial intelligence comes in library of preparation, in interpretation and reporting, and the bioinformatics pipeline. These are all the three things where artificial intelligence is used. Library selection means what is the condition and what we are supposed to look. For example, this is a panel for solid tumor. Okay, if you get any solid tumor, what are all the gene products or genes you have to look in the sequence? This can be identified and selected by artificial intelligence. Okay. Then during the processing in the pipeline, sequence generation, sequence alignment, sequence processing, sequence interpretation can all should be done with the help of artificial intelligence. And there are a lot of open source tools, tools are available to do the artificial intelligence use in next generation sequencing. And these are all the companies involved in next generation sequencing and artificial intelligence. Because of the time constraint, I'm not talking a lot about next generation sequencing. I request all of you to know about next generation sequencing. Here, I want to stress artificial intelligence is very important in next generation sequencing. Now we are moving to natural language processing, or known as NLP. NLP is nothing but interaction between human language and the computer. For example, there is a beautiful girl there. She is telling something, and this is supposed to be the computer, and it is supposed to understand the user's speech. Not only from the speech, it also reads the material, written material, and then understand the thing. And after understanding either the speech or the written material, it can respond. Okay. So the understanding is known as natural language understanding, and the response is known as natural language generation. Okay, the robots respond to users on the basis of understood the content. Remember, nowadays we are getting all customer care. We have a box, okay, chatbot, okay, and whenever you type something, some answers will come, and that is by natural language processing. More commonly, whatever maybe the phone you are using, you are having the voice assistant. In Apple iOS product, we call it Siri. In Google, they call it Google Assistant. And in Amazon, they call it Amazon Alexa. And Samsung, it's called as Bixby. And I use Apple products. I love talking to Siri because it never talks back, and it always respects me, and it gives new nice results to me, always loves me. I kindly request all of you to talk to these things if you are not talked. If you don't have anything to do, you are feeling bored, just to talk to the voice assistants. So what is the use of natural language processing in healthcare? It's here mainly divided into three compartments where there is a proven use: speech recognition, in recording, in electronic medical records, radiology reporting, pathology reporting. We can use speech recognition. We will see it in a minute. Improvement in clinical documents. When you put electronic medical recording, unless you fill some part, it won't take you to the next one. Whenever you are planning to go for accreditation, go for electronic recording, because the documentation will be very good. Data mining research. For example, you want to know how many COVID positive cases on a particular day. Just put in COVID positive cases in your hospital information system. It will give you the number by doing the natural language processing. Computer-assisted coding and automated registry reporting. These are all the proven. What are all the things that are in the pipeline? Clinical trial matching. Running the clinical trials is a big headache, And selecting people for clinical trials is very, very difficult because there will be a lot of inclusion criteria, exclusion criteria. You have to go through all the patient documents and the clinical sheets. But once you computerize them and you tell the criteria to the computer, by natural language processing, it will pick up the eligible and ineligible patients in minutes. So this is very, very useful in clinical trials. Prior authorizations, clinical decision support. This is a major role I will talk about in 1 minute. Risk adjustment and hierarchical condition categories, ambient virtual scribe, and in population health management and analysis. These are all the things in which natural language processing is very helpful in healthcare. And I want you to know two things in the NLP. One is IBM Watson, and the other one is Amazon Comprehend. I don't know how many of you heard of Amazon Comprehend. Amazon is having a nice web-based services, okay? Before 2 weeks, I don't know about Amazon Comprehend. I know about Amazon Prime, seeing a lot of movies there. And by the way, I love movies. You have to see more movies and remember them. That helps to increase your memory. If you cannot remember movies, you cannot remember pathology. So increase your memory powers by seeing more movies. I want to say, I'm not getting any money from Amazon Prime. So let us see what is IBM Watson. IBM Watson is a machine learning tool where natural language processing is used. When you give the patient data, whether you scan it or you put it in voice recognition system or you put the results of X-ray, CT scan, MRI into the machine, it itself is having some question answers, okay? Fill up that questions by Watson and include all the data of the patient, even if there is genetic analysis, sequencing of tumor DNAs done for that particular patient. Give that report, scan it into the computer and give it to the Watson. What Watson does, it analyzes all the data received and it goes through the databases available in the literature, it goes through guidelines, it goes through case reports, clinical studies, and comes up with a diagnosis and a treatment recommendation, okay? This is what IBM Watson does. And it's also known as, I think it's named after Dr. Watson. The Amazon Comprehend is more or less the same. When you provide the medical text, and you have to remember most of the texts we are using are unstructured. For example, when you use the CAP protocol for any cancer patient, it is a structured medical text. When you use your own descriptive reporting, it is unstructured. So all the unstructured notes, clinical trial reports, patient health records, you give it to Amazon Comprehend Medical, and it automatically extracts everything from that. And then this also gives the treatment and the diagnosis. And this helps us in a good healthcare, patient healthcare, and not only in the particular hospital. Remember, all of us are having Aadhaar card, and I'm very happy that the country is going for one number for each person. So wherever you go, when you put that Aadhaar card, all the data will be stored in one place. I may go to Ramachandra today, I may go to Chettinad Hospital tomorrow, but since they used my Aadhaar card, all the data will be one place. And the natural language processing can go through all the data and give the solution for our problem. So this is what is happening in the field of artificial intelligence. Now, after listening all these things, what do you have to do? I want you to give some concrete ideas that you have to do. And they are in couple of threes, rule of threes. Okay, first thing, you have to be positive. Never complain about anything. We are all alive. So many people died, but we are all alive. So be positive. Second thing, only COVID should be negative. Other than COVID, all of the things should be positive. Then, please remain physically distanced, 6 feet apart at all times. Please use mask and please use hand wash in a good manner. There are five steps in hand washing. Please follow them. These three things will keep you alive. Let us worry about artificial intelligence once we are alive. To keep you alive, these three things are very important. Okay, now you are alive. What you have to do? Three things in digital image analysis. First, become a member of Digital Pathology Association. Okay, just put it in Google, Digital Pathology Association. It will take you to the web page. And for all fellows, all PGs and all PhD scholars, it is free. For individuals, it's only $100. Again, I will be using many website names, many companies, many recommendations. And I forgot to put the disclaimer. I don't have, unfortunately, any financial connection with anybody. Whatever I'm telling is to benefit you, because I used them personally and got a lot of benefits. I just request all of you to understand that. After becoming member of Digital Pathology Association, see the WSI teaching slides. In Digital Pathology Association itself, it gives you a lot of resources. The problem is when you get a lot of resources, you don't go through them. So I just want to give you one resource, www.rosaicollection.org. You all know Jan Rosai, the famous editor of Ackerman. Unfortunately, he died 2 months back. All his slides have been imaged and digitally deposited in one site, and this is the site. In addition to the slides, all the descriptions and diagnosis of the slides are also kept as a PDF. And most of the slides are before the era of IHC, so they have been described very nicely. For postgraduates, this will be the best site to learn. Just to see one slide a day. Don't do it more than one per day. Okay, this is the first thing I want you to do in relation to digital image analysis. Second thing, if you have money, buy a old slide scanner and scan the interesting slides. I know, before going that, this is the Rosai Dorfman, Rosai Dorfman disease, which identified by Rosai. But this is Jan Rosai's collection. The J is silent here, so Jan Rosai. And along with the United States and Canadian Academy of Pathology and Leica system, they scanned all his slides. They will be around 10,000, okay? So please visit this site. Then coming to the whole slide scanner, they are running in crores if you want to buy from companies like Leica or Philip. I'm not against them. Quality is very good, but that much money we may not be able to spend. So we found a startup company, Marful. Again, I don't have any connection with them, but we are using their scanner. The service is very good and it is serving the purpose. All of you, please visit this site, Marful. Just put Marful slide scanner in the marfullabs.com. Okay, that will take you. If you don't have money, don't worry. Just schedule a demo. Ask them to bring a machine. See how it is working. Who knows? Tomorrow you may hit a lottery and you can buy it. Okay? Please believe me, it is worth that money. And this cost is around 15 to 20 lakhs, depending upon what you want. Whereas the other machines are more than 1 crore. When I checked last. Okay? So this is more affordable. This is a startup Indian company. And make in India and made in India and made for India. So please use it. And once you got this machine, use some accredited software to assess the ERPR and HER2NU in breast and KA67 in neuroendocrine tumors, because these are all the common markers we use for immunohistochemistry. So these are all the three things you have to do for digital image analysis front. What you have to do for massive parallel sequencing. See, it's a very costly affair. So don't worry about it. Whatever cases you come across that need immunohistochemistry or molecular markers, whether you do it or not, we want to do it, but because of the financial reasons, we are not able to do it. Please write it in the comment. I just put a note, the CT-guided lung biopsy. The final diagnosis is moderately differentiated adenocarcinoma. See comment. In the comment, please mention to differentiate primary from metastatic carcinoma in the lung. Immunohistochemistry for CK7, 20, TTF, and NAPSIN requested. If it is primary adenocarcinoma of lung, EGFR, ALK and PD-L1 suggested. So these are all the immunohistochemistry, and these are all the molecular stuff. We can do it by either ISC, FISH or next generation sequencing. By writing them, we will be aware of what is happening in the world. Don't worry about whether we are doing it or not. Imagine you are Bill Gates. What will you do? Please write it in the report so that we can keep ourselves educated. We can keep our clinicians educated. And before writing this comment, talk to your clinician. They may or don't want to add this, or they may want to add some more tests. Please talk to them and please write it. And then select a reference lab and use that reference lab for affordable patients. Okay. For example, there may be a few patients who can afford these molecular immunohistochemical tests runs in thousands, probably 5,000, whereas molecular tests may run up to 50,000. So when you have an affordable patient, send them to the reference lab. And you visit the reference lab and you see how they are doing it and you see them. And once you send more than 20, whatever number of tests you are sending, keep a tab of it and you use the natural language processing to see how many tests you are sending. The number I use in our lab or we use in our lab is 20 tests per month. If you are sending 20 particular tests in a month to a reference lab, we will start off doing it in-house. The problem here is you cannot run one by one. You have to batch it and you cannot wait for 20 patients to come to run the test because these are all the tests where they need them immediately for treatment. And for our sake, we should not be praying to God, please send me 20 lung cancer patients. Let all the people be healthy. Whether they come to our hospital, that's our motto. All our patients should be healthy. So when you are using the in-house testing, think about turnaround time. If you have a very good volume load, then do it. Otherwise, stay it with the reference lab. And the reference lab which we use is called as Medgenome. And this is the website, diagnostic.medgenome.com. And before selecting a reference lab, please make sure they are accredited by CAP, they are accredited by NABL and other accreditation bodies. And once you select them, stick with them. And if they are not doing the particular test, you ask them to send it to somebody whom they know. They are your outsourcing people. So again, no financial connection, unfortunately, with Medgenome. Lastly, in language, natural language processing, what I want you to do today, three things. Start talking to your mobile tabs, laptops, and computers. Okay, I will show you a picture here. This is the screenshot I took from WhatsApp in our pathology group. And see here, there is a mic sign here. If you click that mic, it will record. As long as you are holding that mic, it will be recording whatever you are talking, and then it will be releasing into the group. And there is another mic, I don't know how many of you know. When you touch the message bar, the message board will come, keyboard will come. Then there is another microphone sign here. And if you press that micro sign, then your phone will act like say, a dictaphone. You can dictate whatever you want to tell. And it will be typed and you can push it to the group after correction. Initially, there may be some mistakes, but once your phone get used to your voice, it will become all right. So I just want you to do that one first. And then use the voice recognition system for dictation. For example, we use for grossing and microscopy, unfortunately, we are not able to use it now because the mic produces a lot of aerosol. We don't want to spread the aerosol in between people. So we are not doing it. So voice recognition system, after we are done with this COVID, we can go for it because it reduces the turnaround time. Then use the CAP protocol for cancer cases. And because once you use the structured data, better search will be done by NLP. And use the data mining for case search. For example, you want to know the CIS stomach cancers in your hospital. We usually go through the old registers. Please don't do it. Go back to your computer department. If you have a computer system, ask them to develop a small program where they can pick up all the cancer stomach patients. So that is known as data mining. These are all the things I want you to do today for natural language processing. So to conclude, machines, can it replace? Artificial intelligence, can it replace human beings? No, they cannot replace. But you ask the question in the different angle, whether the human being, along with the use of artificial intelligence, can they replace another human being? Yes, because they have the power of artificial intelligence. So please remember, a person who knows artificial intelligence can replace a person who don't know artificial intelligence. So please learn artificial intelligence. Conclusion two, I'm just giving an example. 52-year-old male smoker, 3.4 centimeter left lung mass. This is the slides we get for the cases. And imagine there's artificial intelligence. By digital image analysis, it will give the diagnosis as adenocarcinoma, moderately differentiated. Primary can be lung. It needs TTF, NAPSIN positivity, to prove whether it is primary or not. Imagine this is primary lung. So it is positive for TTF, NAPSIN. So it is a primary lung. Then comes massive parallel sequencing. It tells it is EGFR positive and ALK negative. Okay, again, it's artificial intelligence. Then comes natural language processing, where it gives you the favored targeted therapy. And these are all the medicines that are used for EGFR positive cases. So that will suggest these medicines whether to be used or not. Addition to that, it will create the report generator from the HNE findings, IHC findings, molecular findings, and whatever the targeted treatment available. And it will create a final summary or final report, which we call as a final pathology report or discharge summary, that will be created by natural language processing. By doing this, with the help of artificial intelligence, we will have more time to enjoy, relax, learn, improve, and innovate. With that, I just want to finish my presentation, and these are all the references, okay? And when madam asked me on Saturday, I have read this article. Because of this only, I accepted the invitation immediately, okay? It's in Advanced Anatomic Pathology, Artificial Intelligence and Pathology, a Simple and Practical Guide, done in November 2020. The second one is from Nature Journal, Artificial Intelligence and Digital Pathology, New Tools for Diagnosis and Precision Oncology. Third is one from Histopathology that talks about time frames, artificial intelligence, the third revolution in pathology. The fourth is what I talked about, the Digital Pathology Association. This is the website for Digital Pathology Association. And fifth one is for the digital pathology solutions. What are all the companies that deal with digital pathology solutions? So these are all my references. With that, I thank you all for your patient listening. And again, wish you to have a happy International Pathology Day. And I wish you all to have a great time.